Why do you gamble?
Everything in life is a gamble. Everything in life is buy low, sell high. What's the percentage of success in business?
Zero.
Very low. Oh, what's the success on a blackjack trade? Or what's the success on a roulette? What's the success on the flip of a coin? Is the flip of a coin a higher success rate than starting a business? Do you have to gamble on yourself in order to get that promotion? Everything in life is a gamble because everything in life is a game of probabilities. Gambling is a game of probabilities for the person that understands the game. For the person that doesn't understand the game, they think it's a game of luck. So therefore, they operate differently out of life because they think that gambling is something that can't be calculated. But you can actually calculate it. What if you're the house and you know the rules and you know the odds? You're going to always bet on yourself. You're always going to bet on the winning team. You're always going to bet on the winning fighter. Or at least you're going to bet on things that have a higher odd of success. I like to gamble and I like to wager in the stock markets and in the crypto markets for one simple reason. The world is fucked. Let me explain. 1913 rolls around. In pre-1913 Federal Reserve Act, everybody's wage was actually worth something pretty decent. You would work at Henry Ford's factory like we were talking about, and within 4 years you could own a home. You didn't have to speculate. Gambling, speculating, same thing. You buy this watch, which retails 150 grand or some shit, and it's you gamble in the aftermarket that you buy it for $250,000 and that somebody in the future will buy it for the same price or for higher and not the retail price because you'll lose 100 grand, but it's a gamble. But what am I getting from it? Well, I'll get social status and I'll get blah, blah, blah. It's all the calculations that you're making on what the risk reward ratio.
Yeah.
So when you make a risk reward ratio where the risk is low and the reward is high, is it a worthy gamble? Is it a gamble or is it just a good calculated play? It's like a penalty kick. Are you gambling that the goalie is going to go left, right, or center? Well, you're going to have to shoot in one of the three directions. You have a 33% chance of success or a failure. You have a 66% chance of success, depending on if you're the goalie or if you're the person that's kicking the ball. So everything in life is a gamble. So when you look at markets, you look at investment opportunities, it's about making calculated decisions and then with conviction, position your plays, position your opportunities and going after it. A lot of people make decisions out of emotions. I want to make decisions out of the data that is provided to me. So when I said, hey, you know what? I'm going to gamble my way into content creation. I gambled my way into content creation with very solid understanding of CPMs. So when I come from an e-commerce background, I looked at the piece of content because I knew how to create really high quality content creatives that would go viral and gain traffic and make money in e-commerce. I said, what if I took the same piece of content, masterclass, what if I took the same piece of content and understood that this viral clip that I'm making right now is actually in direct proportion to the content clip that people make for an e-commerce store, which is one of two kind of perspectives that can be perceived upon that piece of creative or its task that it's supposed to do. One is convince people to buy, two is go viral. If it goes viral and it converts, it's called what? A winning ad, a winning creative. What if I could replicate that same idea? What is a winning creative? When your CPM and your cost of advertising is lower than the return that you're going to get.
Yeah.
So your margin is good, it's a winning creative. What if with content creation, it's the same thing? I invest into distribution of content or into making YouTube videos. I invest 100,000, but I understand that my CPMs are 50 cents or a dollar or whatever it is. But I know that my throughput and my output will be $2 million in subscriptions and $50,000 in ad revenue and $100,000 in VC checks that I can cut. Okay, well, now I can do what? My analysis to see if I can deploy money into something that actually has a return to it or if it's what? An empty hole. So it's gambling, but I actually get to control the odds and I don't have to put all the chips on the table and it's an end all be all. If I go right now to a blackjack table and I put the chip or like roulette and I put the chip on red and it lands on black, I lose 100%. In the stock market, PayPal goes down 12%. my portfolio is just down 12%. Yeah. So the risk, the bet is more to your favor.
I want to ask you this specifically. So you talk about e-com background. Whenever you have a winning ad, it's simple. You put more ad spend behind it. Maybe you redo the creative and then put ad spend behind that. What do you do when you have a winning piece of organic content?
You post it 100,000 times. If it got a million views and it entertained a million people, then there's pockets of other people that have the same interest as that million somewhere else. I just have to be able to push it enough times for the algorithm to feed it to that group of people and puts you into that people group. That's why I post one piece of content every 4 minutes.
But you package it differently, correct?
Maybe. Slightly. Yeah. Maybe not. The point is, it's a winning piece of content. So my job as a content creator, that's why I got 9 million subs in 1 year. Because you're marketing content as opposed to creating content that is marketable. So my game is a marketing game. It's not a content creator game. That's why content creators experience burnout, because they think that making content is what's going to get you subs. No, it's part of the equation. Marketing the content that you're making is more important than the content itself. Yeah. That's why the guy that says in an interview, why are you gay? You know why that video has billions of views? And it's this only video on the internet of that guy? Is because it's a winning piece of content, it's a viral creative, it causes engagement, and it's evergreen. It can be relevant in 20 years. So you take these four pieces of a formula and you create a piece of content. I need to talk about things that are gonna be relevant in 8 years. You don't think I'm gonna be repurposing this video in 8 years?
Yeah.
100%.
Otherwise, people think the content they're making is the marketing, but it's the product.
Yeah. Correct. It's the creative. It is the ad. And then the distribution is what? The ad dollars. Except you were counting on Meta and Instagram and Snapchat and Google Ads to do the distribution for you. But what happened? Nobody fucking liked boosting their Instagram post because it was gay and it sucked and it was terrible and it was a horrible user experience and it was a pay to play and you only got boosted. And then TikTok rolled around and said, fuck you guys, new algorithm, new Meta, anybody can go viral, just make something dope. It's not about followers anymore. It's about reach. It's about attention. Go for it. Now people get one view that gets a million views. Ah, this is really good. Well, how do you replicate that at scale? Content distribution, understanding and managing the means of content. I remember when I was running meme pages.
Yeah.
And I had one of the, well, it's pretty obvious. I had a representative of the biggest phone company in the world. And you can probably correlate the time that this happened. Reach out to meme pages, paying meme pages to create campaigns of memes making fun of the other phone competitor company that one of their models had blowing up batteries, if you remember. Recently, Samsung. Samsung's main competitor, won't say the name, went to social media platforms and meme pages and said, go make, you know, memes about Samsung's being blown up. It's perception. Controlling the perception at a mass scale through meme pages. But now you're like, well, what if instead of doing meme pages, I just do my own pages and just at a massive scale? Instead of having an ego attached to my page that says at Luke Belmar, well, I'll just own 3,000 accounts instead and just distribute it across multiple people, across multiple metas, which will reach multiple different demographics. It's funny, I had one account that the first three videos I'm talking about, hey, you know, I have people in Africa inside of my community that are making money. I have people in Nigeria that are making money online. And I'm saying, and I said something like joking about, and they, people are talking about the Nigerian scammers in the comment section, and the algorithm picks it up. And now the demographic of that page is literally Nigerian because of the words and the people commenting and all that. So anytime I talk about any sort of content, it feeds it to that audience. If that was my only page, it wouldn't make any sense, but you just have to be cross-border. So back to your question, if you understand distribution and the value of it, you begin to realize that it's not about the product. The product just has to be sticky enough or has to be replica enough. That's why you go to Hollywood or you go to South Korea and they pop out K-pop stars like nobody's business. They all look the same. They all sound the same. They all have similar tunes. There's a formula to it. What matters is the distribution.
So you can take, you manufacture where the content goes to based on the comment section?
100%.
So
based off of everything, based off of what you say on the video, based off of the music, based off of the comments, based off everything.
So theoretically, if a guy popped up seemingly out of nowhere and you had a lot of comments saying like Tate clone, it might push the people to like the audience of Andrew Tate.
100%. 100%.
I've never thought about this before.
Well, there's obviously, because what data points is Instagram pulling to feed you relevancy? Yeah. What are their data points? Except the similarity in pages, similarity in following, similarity in likes, similarity in engagement. That's why you can talk to your girl, be like, oh, we watched that same video, didn't we? Because they realize that they need to share content symbiotically in near-term relationships so people can actually talk about it.
Yeah.
Right? So you have that factor. You attribute that factor into your content and you can manipulate it, you manage it. Some fucking marketing masterclass right here.